are some of these states, particularly Georgia, where they still have a high number of cases, moving too soon? Let's raise that right now with Peter Navarro, of course, the White House Office of Trade and Manufacturing Policy Director. Peter, good to have you.
Good morning, Neil.
What do you think of Georgia's moves? The president, who's open to states getting back to business, was concerned that Georgia was moving a little ahead of its skis. Do you agree with that?
And Neil, I like to stay in my lane, and Vice President Pence is doing a great job on the task force setting out the guidelines. I'll let them speak to that. But the one value add I might have to this is to talk with the American people now about the calculus. We know for a fact that the virus kills directly. We know for a fact that shutting down our economy has destroyed jobs. It's cost enormous stock market wealth loss, which goes into pension funds. We know that it's doing tremendous economic damage. But the more subtle problem, which is a serious problem that comes into the calculus, Neil, is the fact that economic disruptions kill as well. We learned that when China wiped out a lot of their factories in the Midwest. We saw a dramatic rise in suicide rates, death to opioids, death to alcoholism, death to comorbidity increases in things like diabetes. We also saw a sharp blow from the China shock then to the family structure. We saw more divorces. We saw more children in poverty. So when the president has been grappling with this whole issue of when to get the economy back, it's a decision that no president should have to make. It's probably the toughest decision any president has to make. But the people themselves, boots on the ground now, are understanding this tension between the death and destruction that the China virus can cause directly and the death and destruction the China virus can cause indirectly by shutting down our economy. So that's the big picture here, Leo, and we're struggling with that, but we're learning as a people how to fight this virus. This is a war. It's a war that China started by spawning the virus, by hiding the virus, by hoarding personal protective equipment during the time it hid the virus. And now it's ironic and, in my view, disgusting that they're profiteering from that. So this is that's the big picture.
Well, let me ask you about the China part of that, Peter. Could I ask about the China part of that? Because you have long been very critical of China, even in the trade talks. They had to verify everything they did and were promising. I'm just wondering now, they made a lot of commitments to the administration and to the American people about buying a lot more goods from us. But seeing as they misrepresented the seriousness of the coronavirus in their country and might have had some help and assistance in that regard, do you trust them to make good on trade promises they made to you and to us?
Neil, one of the most important documents that got issued this year is the recent Pew Research poll. It's amazing poll. It shows that over 90% of Americans now believe that China's a threat. Over 70% of Americans across party lines have an unfavorable view of China. They are concerned about jobs, the trade deficit, the environment, human rights, and the military. So if you ask me, the author of Death by China and the Coming China Wars, whether I trust China, I would simply say the American people no longer trust China. And there's something I think the Chinese...
So are they going to make good, Peter? Are they going to make good on the
trade deal
they made
well,
to you
certainly,
and the American people? Do you worry about that?
Let's look at the promises they made. They've agreed to buy a tremendous amount of our agricultural products. It's curious that they're now buying a lot of Brazilian soybeans. We're watching that carefully. They also promised to stop all this intellectual property theft and counterfeiting, but we're being inundated now with counterfeit tests for antibodies and other things. And it's so. Do I trust the Chinese? No. Let me give you the something that China would call the four kills. I think it's worth going over because the Chinese effectively declared war. They spawned that virus. The most likely explanation is it came out of a biological weapons lab, probably by accident, but who knows? But more importantly, we know they knowingly hid that virus, Neil, for 6 weeks. That's the second kill, because during that time, hundreds of thousands of Wuhanians and other Chinese flew to places like New York and Detroit and all around, and Milan, all around the world, effectively seeding the planet with this Wuhan virus. And it just, if they had simply been honest with the world, they could have contained it within Wuhan, and we wouldn't be having this conversation. That's the second kill. The third kill, and the China's own customs data, Neil, show this. We saw while they were hiding the virus from the world, they went out and vacuumed up all the PPE around the world, 2 billion masks they bought alone, and they took it from countries in Europe, South America, the United States. And so when the people, the nurses, the brave nurses and doctors on the front lines in New York or Chicago or Detroit or New Orleans needed PPE, part of the reason they didn't have it is because of that third kill. The Chinese had basically vacuumed that up. And now the fourth kill is that they're hoarding that and using that PPE as a weapon in their soft power to project it and to profiteer. I mean, we're seeing, Neil, these are 30, 40-cent masks, 50-cent masks at retail usually, and they're selling them. They're coming to the hospitals here for $7 and $8. And so,
well, it seems to be, Peter, it seems proof that they lied. They lied there with those four pillars you mentioned. They lied four times. Now, I'm just wondering that back in January and February, when you were apparently sending out signals of alarm in this memo that went to the National Security Council and worried about this approaching virus and a potential pandemic, that people didn't appreciate the magnitude of that, because even then you seemed to be sensing that the Chinese might be hiding something. Did that ever reach the level of the president?
Indeed it did. And as I was writing that memo to the task force on the travel ban, President Donald J. Trump had already made the decision to do that. And that was one of the most courageous decisions we've ever seen a president make. He took tremendous heat from that, from all sorts of special
interest groups. No doubt, but he was always convinced that the Chinese were trying to deal with the crisis and that Xi Jinping was being very transparent.
I don't think that's fair to say that wasn't entirely the case, right? Well, there's a difference between public pronouncements and what you actually know and prepare for. And I can assure you that the president...
So he had his doubts back then.
There's no question. Okay. Look, he's one of the smartest guys in the world. He knows there's trust issues with the Chinese. Neil, the thing that bothered me, being a China watcher for many years, is the fact that they came here, shook our hands, broke bread, got near the president on January 14th and 15th. Now, they knew over a month before that we had a pandemic on our hands. You know, the other thing they did, Neil, and this is this whole debate about the World Health Organization, trusted brand prior to this crisis. Now what people know is that China gained control of that agency through a proxy, this guy Tedros. It's from Ethiopia, which is a client state of China. And basically, China was able to hide behind the World Health Organization shield while it sequentially went through these four kills. And, you know, this is a serious point in our history, Neil. What we have to do first and foremost is to deal with this public health crisis, win this war. And one of the things that I'm doing about 40 yards across the street in my office every day is working with a great team on mobilizing our industrial base and supply chain. President Trump's orchestrating the most rapid industrial mobilization that we've had since World War II. If you look at the ventilator issue, which was like the issue du jour over a month ago, and people like Governor Cuomo were wringing their hands and running around with their hair on fire, at this point in time, we are going to have more ventilators than we need, and we're going to have plenty to help our friends around the world. General Motors, to its credit, took 17 days to stand up a factory and turn out its first ventilator. And we were able to deliver those ventilators off the assembly line to hospitals in Gary and Chicago within 3 days. So I'm seeing that.
No, there's
with,
no doubt marshaling those companies to do this was very impressive. But Peter, I did want to get a sense from you now where we're going. And you're talking in the beginning about balancing our economic needs with our health needs. The president did hint that there might be distancing provisions still in effect into the early summer. Isn't that almost inevitably going to mean that the V-shaped recovery hopes for? A lot of people seem to think it's still possible, like Tim Cook of Apple, that that's harder to do. As people come back, they can't crowd into as many restaurants and certainly as many theaters. It'll be a different environment. It might be a slow go, not at all a V-shape.
You began that discussion by saying I had talked about balance or health and economic needs, but that wasn't my point at the beginning. My point is that there's health concerns whether you open the economy or not. In other words, the virus kills directly, but it also kills indirectly when we destroy our economy. Suicides, drug overdoses, all of that. So that's what we're grappling with. And as I said at the outset here, the Vice President, Mike Pence, one of the greatest vice presidents we've had, he's doing a fine job navigating these shoals where it's a learning experience for all of us. But I think that the American people are learning how the social distance, learning how to be responsible in terms of this whole thing.
But will it be a slower recovery as a result? Do you think it will be a slower recovery as a result?
Slower economic recovery or public health recovery?
Right.
Which one?
Slower economic recovery.
Look.
The V-shaped one I was talking about.
Again, I'm not going to forecast that. What I'm going to say is that okay, we're doing our best to defend the American people and the nurses and health doctors at the front lines. We're doing our best move forward with the economy. And don't forget, Neil, we haven't even talked about this, the tremendous work that Congress and the White House have done in terms of stimulus package. So all of this is going to come together. I'm bullish on this economy.
All well said. All right. Thank you. And